What is going on, everybody, and welcome to another support vector machine tutorial. Where we left off, we were running the calculation for every support vector, so we have that now, and what we're going to move into is the calculation for the width that separates the hyperplanes that go through these support vectors. So let's just visualize that real quickly. So you're going to have some vector space, and you're going to have some features. And then real quickly, what are our support vectors? We can look at this and just know, right? We know for sure this is a support vector. And then we know this is a support vector and this is a support vector. The reason why we know this is these are the points where the two parallel hyperplanes with the most distance between them would be going through. But we also know mathematically that what is the definition of the support vector itself? Like mathematically, how do we know it's a support vector for sure? Because this equation is actually something is more like a constraint that we, the scientist, are imposing on a support vector. That doesn't necessarily tell us that we have a support vector because, first of all, we don't even know at this stage what W is and what B is. We just simply know that we want this equation to equal zero, and as you'll soon see, we're going to go through a lot of work to make that the case based on the value we have for x sub I. So this is not the equation that we're going to figure out. We're just going to run this equation and somehow derive what the support vectors are. Instead, a support vector is the, let's say, feature set that if you were to move it, like let's say we took this plus, this bottom plus, and moved it to here, would that affect this hyperplane? Absolutely, right? No longer might that be the best separating hyperplane. It might be something else. And so we call this a support vector because if we moved it, it would affect the rest. It would affect the best separation. So we know what our support vectors are, and then we have our nice, beautiful hyperplane. And the objective, though, if we go all the way back to that first video, was to actually come up with the best separating hyperplane between the data sets. So that separating hyperplane can be calculated simply by taking this right here, right? The width. And then you could take that width, divide it by 2, and then basically from here, you could just plus that width, and you would get yourself to that hyperplane. So we know that we want to maximize that width, and now what we're going to talk about is how we do that. So the equation is for width equals x plus minus x negative, and these are the vectors, dotted with vector w over the magnitude of vector w. So again, what are we wanting to do here? We want to maximize this equation. And then what are basically the variables in this equation? Well, we've got, of course, you know, here, 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 and here. But we actually already know what this and this are equal to, because in the previous tutorial we worked out what the equation is for those values, right? For x minus and x plus, this is the equation that we're using. So pulling that down, we get, right, remember, that's y sub I x I w plus b minus 1 equals 0, and then it was actually the same thing here, right, both of those equations. And if we were to do the algebra in this example, we would find that the x plus is actually, it would come down to being 1 minus b, and then we'd have 1 plus b for the x minus. And then again, if we worked out all of the algebra, we'd find out that this entire width equation comes down to being 2 over vector, the norm magnitude of vector w. Width is equal to 2 over the magnitude of W, and we want to maximize this. So we know we want to minimize that. And then we just simply rewrite. We say, yeah, we want to minimize the magnitude of vector w. And then for just simple mathematical convenience, we're going to say, well, yeah, we want to minimize vector w, or we want to minimize the magnitude of vector w. That means we also would want to minimize 1/2 the magnitude of vector w squared, right? So long as we want to minimize just simply the magnitude of vector w, we'd also want to minimize 1/2 the magnitude of vector w squared, right? That works. So we do that for mathematic convenience, that we're about to plug it into an equation, and that's just going to make it a little easier for us. So we want to minimize 1/2 the magnitude of vector w squared. So we want to minimize 1/2 of the magnitude of vector w squared with constraint to our support vectors, which we have defined as being y sub I times x sub I by w plus b minus 1. That is our constraint.
Ah, someone said the C word. There's a knock at the door. It's Lagrange. He brought his multipliers, and together we're going to work on this problem.
So then we're going to have our Lagrangian, and it's going to state that the L w b equals what we already decided was going to be our statement for the magnitude of w, and that was going to be 1/2 the magnitude of vector w squared minus the sum over alpha I, where alpha I is our Lagrangian multiplier. And then the constraint we have is the constraint that we defined as being our support vectors. So that was y sub I multiplied by x sub I w plus b minus 1. And that is our initial statement here that we need to optimize. And so again, we want to minimize w, and we actually want to maximize b. So why do we want to maximize b? And what exactly is b? Well, if we look at the really simple equation for a hyperplane, so the equation for a hyperplane is just wx plus b. What's that look like? That looks a lot like mx plus b, right? For the simple line. And what happened when you modified b? Well, what even was b, right? Well, b was just your y-intercept. And if you modified where the line intercepted the y, that would just move it up or down. The same is basically true for a hyperplane. So to exemplify this, let's draw some vector space. And then let's add a couple hyperplanes. Actually, we'll start just by adding a single hyperplane. So this is a hyperplane, right? It's all filled in. And then what if you were to add b? Well, if we added b, let's say b, this is b, we're adding b, it moves you up. So then if you had another hyperplane, you'd have this. And what you've done here is you've added to b. So you've basically shifted this hyperplane. And b, in terms of the support vector machine, is generally going to be called bias. And that's kind of why we're actually using b here. So heading back to our Lagrangian here, we need to differentiate L with respect to W, and we also need to differentiate L with respect to B. So differentiate L with respect to W, and then we also need to differentiate L with respect to B. Okay, so when you did, let's say first we'll do differentiate L with respect to W. You're going to find that you've got, basically, it's going to come down to being vector w minus the sum over alpha I yi xi. which then simply becomes, when you move this w basically, but we'll just add the equal sign here. So it simply becomes vector w equals the sum over alpha I, y I, x I. And I'll go ahead and make x I official. Okay, so then we can differentiate L with respect to B now. So we can say differentiate L with respect to, whoops, differentiate L with respect to B. And what we get there is going to be minus the sum over alpha I, y I. And you would say that is equal to zero. But then you can actually just, you would come up with L with respect to B is the sum over alpha I, y I. Then what we come up is L equals the sum I over alpha I minus 1/2 of the double sum of I and J over alpha I, alpha J, Y I, Y J dotted with vector X I dot X J. And we want to maximize this. So we know we still have this constraint optimization problem, but right away we should recognize this alpha by alpha, this alpha squared. When you see that, we recognize, we have a quadratic programming problem. So understandably, some of you might be a bit fuzzy at this point. If that's you, that's totally fine and honestly should be expected. If you're not lost or confused and this is your first time learning about the SVM, you're a robot. So what I've shown so far is the more formal and traditional calculation for the support vector machines optimization, along with some of the facts and assertions that an SVM just has. So it's important to at least be familiar with this stuff, as you're going to see these formulas if you continue working with SVMs. Also, you need to know them if you're going to work with an optimization library, and you definitely need to know how the SVM works if you intend to, you know, make your own like we do in the series. It's also important, I think, to cover the more formal calculation of an SVM or the typical calculation, because I think it really highlights some of the downsides and upsides to the SVM. So one of the downsides is the just complexity, both in math, but in also the optimization problem itself. The other major downside of the SVM is that you need all of your feature sets in memory to optimize. So if you have a really large data set, this might not be feasible. Like a data set that's 100 gigabytes or something, that's not outrageous. Okay, so I mean, that's a huge data set, but I mean, it's not too crazy in this world. And the chances of having 100 gigabytes on your typical machine, I mean, you might have a big giant machine, but probably not. So that's gonna be pretty hard. Now, of course, this was a problem with K nearest neighbors as well, but this is one of the major downsides to the SVM. Now, there are methods to kind of work with small or larger data sets, and you can do it with like mini batches basically. Probably the most popular choice nowadays is sequential minimal optimization, or SMO, which was created by John Platt actually quite a while ago at Microsoft. But that's probably now the most common used one, if I was to make a guess. But anyways, either way, the SVM can be pretty cumbersome at scale. Now, the upside, though, is once you have trained a support vector machine, you do not need the old features anymore. And a classification for a new data set is just WX plus B. And not even just WX plus B, it's the sine of WX plus B, right? And not sine as in cosine, sine, and all that. Sine as in, is it a positive or a negative? If it's a positive, it's a plus class. And if it's a negative, it's a negative. So anyway, in the next video, I'm going to hopefully clear up some of the fuzziness, if you have it here, by dramatically simplifying our problem, which we can do since we have a pretty decent foundation, I think, now of the support vector machine and its constraints. And then hopefully I'll be able to get you completely clear when we go to write our own support vector machine from scratch in Python, because we are actually going to write our own optimization algorithm in Python. And I think once you do that and you recreate the support vector machine and do the prediction, the training and all that, I think that's going to help tremendously. At least for me, I was pretty fuzzy until I actually tried to do it myself. So hopefully it will help you as much as it did me. So anyway, I kind of suggest you hold your questions until at least the next video when we kind of do basically a recap and simplify the math that we've seen so far, but you can still leave one below if you want. Otherwise, you can of course leave comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.